That's very odd. I don't know why. Let me see if that went back up now. Let's see if we're back up. Okay. Shadowed says back. Rogan says back. We're back. Okay. So we're back up. Okay. Not sure why that happened. There have been a couple of issues with Twitch over the last couple of weeks with streams randomly disconnecting, not just mine. So anyway, sorry about that. Okay. Sorry, guys. So I believe where we lost them, Neil, you were just in the middle of explaining that it was sort of like fitting into the world aesthetic. So maybe we could start back there if you can back yourself up to that part of the answer.
Yeah, I'm just going to say, I mean, yeah, it was just making sure that it fit into the theme of the world. And yeah, but I don't seem to remember there being any major problems at all with that. Dylan took on my feedback and just completely nailed it, like came back with revised changes and whatnot. And then what we tend to do as part of our process as well is we tend to flourish it afterwards, because obviously we know the world really well, and obviously we've got books from previous game books in the series that, you know, there might be characters or key events or places that are mentioned in those books, or that you actually, you know, as the adventure unfolds, you actually make happen. Mm-hmm. And I'm a big fan of continuity, so, you know, it's good to sort of sprinkle those bits of information within the books. So people, regular readers, go, I see how that fits into the grand scheme of things. That's kind of clever. And Dylan's book was ripe. We had a book, Game Book Adventures 4, Revenant Rising, which was set in a city called Falavia. There was this guy who thought he was a bit of a god, and he'd got this weapon, and he thought he was pretty powerful. And we suggested that he came from a town called Newroth, and he was one of these family clans that run this town. And we thought, wouldn't it be great if we could actually go to Newroth and actually find out more about these family clans? And it was just a case of, you know, just adding in little touches just to make it fit within the broader, you know, world storyline and epicness of stuff. But that would have been only minor little bits we added in there. We didn't ask Dylan to add those, because it was just easier for us to quickly change those on the fly.
So that's the you are the Stan Lee, in essence, of Tin Man Games, responsible for all continuity across platforms, books, and everything else, essentially.
I am the Stan Lee, but unlike Stan Lee, I don't appear in any of my books.
That's true. And I wanted to say, while we're on the subject, because I've been insanely happy about this, what game book is it that my flute is going to appear prominently featured?
It's this one.
Is it Lords of Norrath? I'm so excited about that.
I've got my digital copy up here. I'm just gonna make sure that it is this one, because I'm pretty sure I got Kamina to add it.
So excited about that.
Yeah, I've just found it. Yeah, there it is. Pick up Elrond's flute. There it is.
It was so funny. This if those of you in chat may remember that this was during my Ultima Underworld playthrough, and I was trying to find this goddamn flute that I dropped somewhere on level 3 or something. And this is before the days when games wouldn't let you throw away things that were very obviously important. But they didn't do that, and I couldn't remember what it was, so I was looking all over creation to find this bloody flute that I needed. And so at a certain point, Neil happened to be watching the stream at the time, and at a certain point he's like, you know, this gives me a thought. And I was like, well, listen, you know, I think I'd love it if, you know, somehow my flute or something like that, some object shows up, and he said, I'm going to add your flute to a store somewhere in the game book. So I feel like the official aspect of the bucket list has been fulfilled insofar as I now have a flute showing up in a game book. So I'm super excited about that. I just insanely pleased. I feel like I've arrived through my flute.
But what you don't realize is that we're going to be taking this forward, you see, and you know, you need a collection of musical instruments.
Elrond's horn, Elrond's drum.
So right. So it's going to appear. It's going to be there, and we might, and because we can edit our game books whenever we want, we can retroactively add in objects to previous titles.
Yes. So, well, you know, yeah, no, yeah. In fact, we've done that. I mean, I, you know, on House of Hell, we caught 3 or 4 typos when Kamina, you know, so I actually watched in real time as the book was updating, you know, while we were playing. And I'm like, that's pretty classic to be able to do that. So that was
I'm sure that will happen again today. I have the file open and ready.
We are prepared to do it. Yeah, exactly, Jen. Ladies and gentlemen, Arvin and the Ailerons live in concert. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. And you need the Aileron set. Like, if you get the whole set, you get like a whole new game book, a whole new vista. It opens up. That'd be pretty awesome. That'd be pretty exciting. All right. Well, let's actually shift over then. And again, I am very pleased to be joined by Dylan Birtolo, who's the gentleman. There he is. Gentleman to my left on your screen. That is the writer of Lords of Nuroth. And then not pictured, not seen but heard, is Neil Rennison, who is Rennahammer in chat. He's the CEO of Tin Man Games. And so we're going to switch over and actually move into the game itself. So I'm going to do that. And I'm going to capture this. I've already got the game captured, but I want to make sure that I have you guys captured as well. So bear with me just a second.
I had a little chat with Kamina this morning, and I said to Kamina, so we tested the Android version really well, didn't we?
And she said, yes. Sort of.
Yeah, Android can be a bit problematic for us because there's so many Android devices we inevitably run into problems here and there because, you know, we don't have a 100-man Q&A department. Mm-hmm. But we do our best, but sometimes a few slip through, so I'm hoping it'll be good.
I imagine it will be. I can't imagine it would not be a problem. Let me see. Let's go into that. Let's move out of full screen. All right, let's see if that makes a difference. Ah, there we go. Much better. That's what we were looking to do. Game capture is bad. Yeah, I know. I'm getting game capture working. I'm using, to do this, this is still only on Android, so I'm using the BlueStacks app player, which works. But it means that I've got to make a couple of adjustments that I have to make as well. So that is why we are doing what we are doing. So now I'm going to bring on my own picture, and then I'll bring on Dylan's, and then we'll be good to go. All right. So as I'm doing this, then Lords of Nuroth is your newest original, right? Or am I wrong about that? Is it the newest original?
It is, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what would you say, because I talked a little bit with Dylan about this before you came on, but you don't have to tell me, like, specific sales figures, but I know that the Fighting Fantasy game books tend to do, you know, better than the originals do. Mm. But obviously you're trying to get a situation going where, you know, eventually all of your things sell really well, and, you know, as long as it's in the Fighting Fantasy style. So I'm curious, like, what the sort of response has been from people out there to this game. Your senses of that?
So it's not great, to be honest. So what as tends, like, you're right, the licensed properties obviously sell copies just on the name at times, but Game Book Adventures has always been kind of it's been the thing that's kept us going, and what we found was that as we jumped into licensed stuff, is that, you know, the Game Book Adventures series kind of sat in the background a little bit, fermenting, though, like a fine wine.
Yes.
and like, you know, Dylan, like, we spoke about writing this a very long time ago, or a long time ago in for us. And actually the book was finished, written, probably a good couple of years ago, Dylan. Would that be about right?
If you give me just a few seconds, I can tell you the date. Let's see here. So, yeah, it was finished on January 2nd, 2013.
Yeah, there we go. So it's been sat there waiting to be done, and I've said so many times, I think Dylan probably sent me an email every now and again going, how's it going? And I'd be like, yeah, we're going to start it next month, and blah, blah, blah. And it's just one of those things where when, you know, I run a company and we have to look at what we're doing, and you know, we're trying to grow the company, we're employing new people, so obviously our outgoings get higher. And really, you know, the licensed products sell better, so we've had to concentrate on those more, just to keep the train on the track, really.
And I do hope that I never pushed too much. I tried to walk
no.
the line between being understanding and being really excited and wanting to see this come to fruition.
Yeah, no, you didn't at all. It was, if anything, I was, I think we were feeling a bit guilty that we weren't getting onto them sooner. And we started the app development a number of times and then had to put it down because we had to jump into something else. But it was really important to us. There's another two books after this, Game Book Adventures 11 and 12. And we have a similar situation where they were also written and delivered to us quite a long time ago. And we're currently, in fact, Kamina at the moment is working very hard in getting those prepared to be released. So,
by which we mean breaking them as much as possible, right?
Yeah, she has a habit of that, doing that, yeah.
So it makes her good at what she does. Yeah, I actually had someone in chat ask if she had worked on this one, and I assume she did for like QA purposes and things like that, right?
Well, actually, no. This was the first book that Kamina has actually been, I wouldn't say a full-scale producer on the book, but in terms of actually getting it into our engine and making it all work, she was a key person doing that. Because it was really important for me to give Cam the opportunity to, actually do more of the actual development work and not just be QA, or she's traditionally done a lot of QA and kind of customer feedback stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And this was one of the first titles she worked on where she's actually put it together herself, and so
nice.
It was really cool, and now, like, for example, she's now running with the other two because she now knows a lot of the processes in place to get things done. So she's, very important part of this book.
That's awesome. Well, she and Ben both are well loved by this chat, so I'm glad to see that she's getting further sort of advancement, as time goes on. That's awesome. Also, I've just been told by my chat that the channel has gotten the transcoder, which means that people will be able to view it in any quality from low all the way up to source, that's good news, because that means we will be able to get people watching you regardless of their internet connection. So that's awesome. So good.
Yay.
I'm glad to say it. Thank you, Twitch. All right, let's actually get into the game here and let's play it. And by the way, this is set in the same universe as Assassin of Orlando's, right? Like, so it is part of the same overall universe and world.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
It is. Yeah. It's set a few years after Assassin of Orlando's. So.
Okay. All right. That's good. I did play Assassin, but I don't remember because I've had so many things since then. Okay. So, you guys know the deal with this chat, which is you must choose your skill level. So we've got Classic for the true hardcore gamebook hero. Play GA how it was meant to be played. I like how it's placed first and all of these things, like play it the way that the real people play it. It's judgment, skill, and a bit of luck. Vitality, blah, blah, blah. Adventurer for the more relaxed adventurer. Starting vitality, unlimited bookmarks. Or casual, filthy casuals. This is for the casual gamebook reader who wants it. No, we're going to go with classic. So we're going with classic. Now, here we go, chat. This is going to be your first chance to do this. So here we go. Here we go. Are we going to be... All right, there we go, folks. Are we going to be a man or a woman? Please vote in chat. Choose. You know how to do it. Exclamation point, choose one will give you man. Exclamation point, choose two will give you woman. So let's choose this, and then we will pick a name. So I'll ask about names next.
An interesting point, this is the first GA where it allows you to choose your sex.
Ah, very cool. That's very cool, actually.
And by the way, that also made it very interesting to write for as the writer.
Yeah, did it change things around considerably, I imagine. Well, you get the chance to go back to work. No, you rat bastard. You will not get the chance to go back to work, illness. you guys, before we came on, Neil was saying that this is actually a joke in Tin Man's offices about the whole appointment with work, which is what our channel decided to make it because reasons.
Yes. Well, this will suit your watch as well, because in theory you're a thief in this, and so your job is to steal things. So
okay,
you're working all the time.
Okay, that sounds that kind of works all the time. Oh, so I have two votes going on at the same time. All right, well, That's fine. We'll have two bowls. We'll have two polls going on at the same time that will give the same result. So that's fine. All right, last call. Last call, chat. Last call. Smacky butts. Votes for man. Oh man. Okay, here we go. Okay. Thank you very much, Shadowed. Okay, I know exactly, gentlemen. Finally finished writing this book. Now to add an S before every he and an R after every he. Wait. Damn it. Okay. So the choice is we have chosen a woman. Okay. Next, we're going to choose a name. Now, this one, to avoid too much sort of silliness, I think I'm going to give the writer of the book an opportunity to choose a name for chat this time. Dylan, it's all up to you. You could name it whatever you like.
I'm horrible with names. Please do not make me do this.
Are you seriously saying I can't talk to a writer about coming up with a name for a character? Is that really?
Yes, I am saying that I spend more time coming up with the name sometimes than the
than anything else. All right, I will throw it to Neil then, our other guest. Neil, what would you like for a name?
Let me think. Do you know? I don't know. Gosh, it's putting me on the spot. I don't know. Call the Tin Lady. I don't know.
Tin Lady. How about how about Tenedia? How about that?
Oh, I can see.
Tenedia. There we go. What? Oh, I see why. Tenedia. Okay. Done. Lovely. Okay, now we're going to roll for vitality. Lady face poopy pants. Lovely, Smacky. Lovely. I'm sure that's exactly what happened. Roll for vitality. Oh, God, no. Yes, I love the being able to... Where did you get the idea, by the way, Neil, for the hitting the book to make the dice change their movement? Because that's so exactly the way it often was. Like, I'm just curious. Did you think about that from your past? And
so it's one of those weird things where when we did Assassin and Orlando's, I think it was in there as a bit of an accident because it was using the shake on the iPhone.
Okay.
Using that tech. And I remember when I was working with Ben, a different Ben, not Ben Cosmina, but the original Tin Man founder with me, Ben. And I said, let's just leave it in there. I think it's kind of cool. It's like the nudge of a pinball table.
Yep.
You know, it's
yep.
In, yep. And people really respond to it. They love it. So
I liked it too. I was a big fan. okay, so now you must roll for your fitness. Fitness represents how fit and agile you are. There will be key moments in the story, and during battles, you need to make a fitness check. Higher the value, the better. Fitness is calculated by rolling one die, adding the number to 6 for a minimum of 7, a maximum of 12. Our fitness is not a 1. Our fitness is a 1. God, it's a 1.
Yay!
That is terrible. I blame chat. All right, next up, your 4 new abilities. You play a cunning thief in Lords of Nuroth, and as a thief, you start the adventure with 4 extra abilities: perception, stealth, thieving, and persuasion. During the course of the story, you will be asked to make a skill roll in relation to each ability. These roles are dictated by the difficulty of the situation you are in. The higher your skill, the more chance you'll have in succeeding with your task. Okay, yeah, thanks, Shatter. Okay, so let's open a poll and see which one of these we're going to give the most attention to. So, let's see. We'll make this... Okay, so you guys can now vote on that. Vote for which one of these you'd like to be the primary skill. What's the one that you want to concentrate the attention on? Perception, stealth, thieving, or persuasion? What do you want to focus our attention on? And were there changes, while they're doing that, let me ask you guys, were there changes in terms of, obviously there were some differences from the fighting fantasy typical skill, stamina, and luck, but were there changes in terms of what skills were available? Like, how did you determine what skills were going to be focused upon or not? I'm curious.
So when I was writing this book, Neil actually said to me, so you can have 3 or 4 skills. You should pick what they are. which was pretty much how it got started.
Okay.
So I tried to pick skills that I thought would make sense for a thief, and then also the different ways to play it. Like, for example, one of my absolute favorite games in history for modularity is Deus Ex,
right,
because of how many different ways you can approach something. So when I was writing this, I tried to make sure that even if you were only good in one of these, you'd be able to get to a, I don't want to say happy end, but like a resolution to the story, even if you only focus on one.
Right.
But what you're going to have to do will be very different.
I see. So you were really responsible for these four skills, and they were just able to like fold it smoothly into the game book and the design then.
Yes and no. I again had back and forth with Neil. He was very helpful about, well, let's try to make them more separate, or okay, these are good, but did you think about adding in persuasion? So there was still back and forth. It wasn't like I said, okay, this is what we're going with, but it was more or less my idea with what to start with.
I see. Okay.
At the time, we were developing the Judge Dredd game book, and one of the things that we needed to do with Judge Dredd was make sure that the gunfights were really quick and snappy, mm-hmm. Because our turn-based combat can be a little bit slow, and that doesn't work so well for shootouts, really. And so we developed this thing called a difficulty roll, which involved having certain abilities to fire your weapons and various things. And it was about this time we wanted to kind of bleed this into our other products, and it's probably about this time that me and Dylan probably swapped emails about it, and I suggested the idea. So.
Oh, cool. So he was the pioneer, sort of, so to speak, or this book.
I'd say guinea pig.
Nice.
Both work.
Nice. All right. Well, the will of chat is that perception and persuasion will be the top two. So we will add, let's see, increase perception by one. And I guess what we'll do is we'll put 2 points into that. We will do an extra point into persuasion eventually.
Right. Your chat does not like stealing things.
No. They're just like, you know, stealing is just not, that's not for the strong. And I think they really liked perception, so we're going to go with that, I think, the last time, if I can. We've used them all up. All right, good, lovely. And then the number of bookmarks available. You tap the center of the screen, bookmark up in the upper right corner, allow you to save your game at any point in the book. You get 6 bookmarks, so use them wisely. Start your adventure. Lovely. Here we go. 16th June is 776 dawn years. Your fingers slide across your belt as you walk along the fairly crowded street. As you pass over the hidden pockets sewn into the inside, a smile creeps across your lips. There is an almost imperceptible bulge concealing the rewards for your efforts earlier this afternoon. To most, it will be nothing more than a pretty ring, but to you, it is the key that will lead to even greater fame and fortune. You have just enough time to drop it off with your employer before meeting another client to discuss a possible job. As you pass by Falstaff Alley, you see 3 pickpockets standing at the corner, eyeing the crowd in an attempt to determine their next target. 2 of them match your stare and give a subtle nod of recognition. You return the gesture and then quickly look away to not draw attention to them. Honor amongst thieves and all that. By the way, I noticed that we're using the British spelling here, so I assume, Dylan, you fought like mad to avoid that, but were outvoted ultimately by the need to add unnecessary U's into everything.
I'm pretty sure that was changed post-submission.
Wasn't yeah, it was a thing. Yeah. Sorry about that, Dylan.
It's just reacquiring goods that were somewhat abandoned. That's exactly right. That one is Talisman of Death, shadowed, is the one you're talking about with the dragon. Yes. And by the way, for those of you who have come in, I am interviewing Dylan Birtolo, the writer of Lords of Nurath, the newest game book from Tin Man Games, newest original game book, and Neil Rennison, the CEO of Tin Man Games. And in just a moment, I'm going to open up questions to chat to let you guys ask questions as well. This game that I'm playing is available on Android and iOS, and you can currently get them either one. I believe it's $4.99, if I'm not mistaken, on Google Play, anyway, on the Play Store. So I assume it's similar on iOS as well. By the way, are there plans to, as you did with Appointment with Fear, move this over to PC or not, Neil? Is that not going to happen?
Yes. We've just released Assassin and its sequel Curse, the Assassin, on Steam.
Okay.
We're about to release Catacombs of the Undercity, which is Game Book 5. So yes, as and when, really. It's you know, we're currently we've only been on Steam a little while, so we're just currently going through the back catalogue and picking out titles which we think should go up there. So
gotcha. Steam has been a good thing for you guys, though, hasn't it? I mean, there's been good things from that, has it?
Surprisingly so. Like, it's just like The Forest of Doom and Starship Traveller have just been done amazingly well on Steam.
Yeah.
And it's, I think what it's done more than anything, apart from obviously making a bit of revenue, which is a help, it's brought our attention, brought us to, you know, I guess the YouTube generation, because a lot of people are recording playthroughs and doing various things.
Yep.
And I just, it was a surprise to me. I didn't think it would be something people would want to cover, and it's been, you know, really popular, so it's been really great.
Yeah, one of the most popular of the videos on my YouTube channel actually is the House of Hell playthrough.
Oh,
mostly
wow.
Just because of all these comments, you know, with people saying, "Oh my God, this was such a brutal book. I can't. This is such a and it is a brutal, ridiculous, unfair, torturous book." which was not your fault. That was the way it was to begin with. I actually was just found out, by the way, that the original edition, American edition of that, which I have, with the cover of the guys descending the stairs, actually is worth a lot of money, because I guess a lot of them were burned by people who were talking about it being a satanic cover. The British one didn't have this problem. But yeah, so apparently it's worth a lot of money, and I did not know that. Yes. So anyway, I thought that was interesting. Yeah, the kitchen is doomed. We ended up even making a command out of it, because if you get into the kitchen in House of Hell, you'll never escape. You can't escape. It is a loop of death. They literally made a whole bunch of entries that have no purpose, because you can't escape the entries. It's just, it's amazing. Steve Jackson at his best. The other Steve Jackson. Yeah, right? Okay. You wind through the dusty streets of Noroth, making your way to your employer's house, this large building easily dwarfing all of the hovels around it. By the way, Dylan, did you have this art? The art came later. Did you have any of the art to work with, or not?
No. Basically, after I submitted the story, one of the things that I had to submit with the story was descriptions for their artists of what different pieces of art I think should be included. I think there were 30. I'm not sure on that number.
Yeah, 30. Yeah.
Okay, so you didn't know about it until afterwards, but
right.
And did you say I missed that part. Did you just say you were able to choose among them? You had like a selection. Is that what you said, or did I miss that?
So basically, what Neil came to me and he said that part of my submission, I was supposed to include a suggestion of 30 different pieces of artwork that would fit.
I got you.
Every
the suggestion.
Couple of sections and stories, and to come up with descriptions that could be handed to the artist, so the artist wouldn't need to necessarily read the whole book and could just read the description and be like, oh, okay, I can make a illustration of that.
Nice. What do you think about the, I hate to put you on the spot, but I think I know the answer. What do you think of the art that they came up with, Endel?
Oh, it was gorgeous. I got to see as it was being completed, and unfortunately for Neil, it made me all excited and means that I started, you know,
sending him emails again.
Of, hey, so when do you get to see it?
This is great. We're going to get to see more. That's funny. That is funny. Okay. Cool. All right. Let me move on here. I'll let Chad ask questions in just a second. It stands 3 stories tall and is almost as wide as the tavern across the street. 2 pillars frame the entrance to a wooden door with a large iron knob. Looking up, you can see the door leading to the second floor balcony is open to let in the late summer air. You know you were expected, and a mischievous thought enters your mind. If you wish to climb up to the balcony or choose to enter the house via a more conventional route, the door. As I prepare to be not surprised by Chad's reaction. Chad, I don't think we need a poll. Well, actually, yes, we're going to do a poll here because it'll be fast. Balcony. Here we go. All right, guys, do you want to go up to the balcony or do you want to go via the door?
Because as you will know, Greg, from seeing me at conventions, I never do anything mischievous that
No,
involved.
No, not in the least. You're
and
very conventional.
And it never ends horribly.
Yeah, no, it's always very straight ahead and no surprises ever. That's kind of your you know, way of, that's your MO, so, you know. All right, yes, and so far we have an almost overwhelming, except for Abmi, who chose door, and Rogan, and I'm guessing both of them chose those to be contrary. Actually, if I pushed it far enough, Chat would end up doing it just to be contrary to my suggestion, but I feel like Chat is going to see a balcony and be like, clearly we go to the balcony. That's, you know, I'm just guessing that that's going to occur.
What was your fitness score again? Just checking.
Yeah, no. Actually, the fitness was the one was pretty solid. That was about a 44. It was the no. You're right. No, that was my that was the other thing. That was stamina, health. Is that the
vitality was good.
Vitality was good. The fitness was not. I guess it's a good thing vitality is good because the fitness is not so hot. Isn't this a perception thing though? Isn't it clear that we perceive whether we can make it and therefore we don't go out there at all?
You do know I can edit the game book right now and make it that way if you want me to.
That'd be awesome. We get up there and all of a sudden it's like you're about to fall, and then all of a sudden the screen just shakes and it's kind of, and you make it through with absolutely no problems whatsoever. Hashtag kissing up to the chat. Because crossed is in my name. Yes, yes. Okay. And the will of chat is with a, not actually a little bit closer than I thought, but still 7 votes in favor of the balcony.
Almost 2-1.
Yeah, so that is fairly strong. So climb up to the balcony. Still on a high, and perhaps just high, from your success earlier in the day, you decide to make a grand entrance by appearing unexpectedly on the second floor. Your employer is up, first typo of the day, awaiting you, in one word. As opposed to awaiting space you. Do you see that, Neil?
Sorry?
I said it's, you have on the page, it's awaiting you, as two words made into one word by accident. and this will just further serve to impress. You immediately start to scale the pillar, your fingers finding small cracks to leverage to pull yourself up. People on the street gasp and point, forming a half circle beneath your feet. The attention of the crowd spurs you on as you scramble towards the balcony. You make one last heave and launch yourself up, ready to catch the railing. Make a fitness check. Well, yeah, the page will get a tiny footnote. Shattermage. Hello, awaiting you. I am Shattermage. Exactly.
By the way, I've just fixed it, but I haven't uploaded it yet.
Okay, that's fine. By the way, first try without having to shake it, no problem with a fitness check. No issues at all. At the peak of your jump, you reach out and snag your fingers on the balcony edge. I'm actually going to give you a chance to ask that question in just a moment, Adam. With a heave, you pull yourself up, kicking your legs out and circling over the railing. You land on the balcony and the balls of your feet making almost no noise at all. You turn to face the crowd below and give them a devilish smile before turning back to the doorway. You see Sarid, your employer, standing behind a desk with his back to you. He is intently focused on the parchment scattered across the desk. A half-empty bottle of wine rests next to a gold chalice at his side. He reaches out with a hand covered in 3 jeweled rings to pick it up and takes a deep swallow. You inch inside the room and slide to the side so your back rests against the wall. You wait for him to put the drink down and then cough to announce your presence. All right. Now, with that said, because Chad has been so patient, I'm going to give them the opportunity. I'll start with Adam's question, but can everybody else who wants to ask a question, the way it works is, please type in all caps the word question and then colon and then whatever your question is for either Dylan or Neil or both. And I will feed those questions on to these gentlemen. So again, all capitals, question, then colon, and then whatever your question is can be done just in sort of normal lettering. But I'll start with Adam's question. Adam asks, Dylan, how much planning goes into developing one of these game books? And I think you answered a little bit of that before, but maybe you could, for people who just came in, repeat a little bit about the amount of planning you had to do for sort of the non-linear nature of it, I guess. Or I should say, the branching storyline, having to be able to think about the branching story parts.
So I think the best way to phrase it would probably be to compare it to writing a normal story. And basically what I did was I came up with a general storyline of what I wanted to happen and then tried to figure out different ways that could alternate and that you could take branching paths to wind up at what essentially winds up being these nodes. If you lay out the entire story, you'll see that there's a bunch of different paths and then there's like 5 or 6 nodes throughout the story that you'll hit pretty much every single time. But your equipment might be different, your situation might be different, the verbiage of those sections might be different based on those things. Mm-hmm. But there are these key elements that you will always hit. And writing a linear story for that amount of planning would probably, or at least planning it out and sketching out the outline, would have probably taken just an hour or so if it was linear. But making it non-branching, I'd say that probably multiplied it about 5 or 6 times of wow. Trying to figure out different ways to get there and how that situation could be different, because you want to make sure that, and as you'll see here, you're going to have an opportunity, well, depending upon what the stream chooses, you might have an opportunity here to drastically change the way this entire game plays out. And I don't remember off the top of my head, but there's three or four choices that drastically change it. But I wanted, no matter what you choose, for it to still be a steady story. And that's where the time gets multiplied.
I see. How many, would you have a sense of what the overall word count was of this film, vaguely?
I don't, but I can actually pull it up on my computer and tell you.
Okay, I like that. And what's up, 5x9? Hello, EMC. Hello, everyone who's just come in. Reminiscent of the game, the old text-based adventures like Adventure in Zork. Yeah, for sure, 5. And actually, this is really based on the Fighting Fantasy game books, like the ones that I do on stream. But this is an original from Tin Man Games. So what'd you get?
It is about 85,000 words.
Okay. All right. So, yeah. So full length, pretty much. Cool. All right. So that's cool stuff. Yeah. Where is the flute? Rennie Hammer asks. That is an excellent question. I will put that to Neil. Neil, where is the flute?
I'm asking myself the question. Well, you'll have to find it. That's
where is the flute? We have to find it. But again, guys, go ahead and send along those questions. Any questions you like about the nature of the book, what this is available for, other adventure possibilities. If you have suggestions about, if anyone has a question about when this is getting ported to Linux, I'm just kidding. But that could be possible.
You jest though, but our Steam versions do work on Linux. So.
They do work on, check you out. That'll make the Linux. I do have some very, very devoted, well, I guess all Linux people are extremely devoted to Linux, but my Linux people are very devoted, in particular among that group, to Linux. So, let's see, Sarah
jumped.
I'd
just like to point out that I want to know where the flute is, because that was added after edits, and I have no idea.
You have no idea where it is. Yeah, no, I know. Sarah jumps and places one hand to his chest. To his credit, his other hand immediately reaches under the table and pulls out Arvin's flute. No, pulls out a dagger. He turns to face you, raising the dagger in a throwing position. You step out of the shadows, holding your hands up in a gesture of peace. Once he recognizes you, Sarah lets go of the breath he was holding, and his shoulders relax. However, he continues to stare, holding the dagger up, ready to throw. You begin to feel nervous and tense your legs, anticipating an attack. He then bursts out in a hearty laugh and drops his arm.
Ha! You're even better than I thought, and better than your reputation gives you credit. You just may even be better than I was in my prime.
You stinking bastard. Do you have it? Sarah asks, leaning across the desk in anticipation. You reach into the hidden pocket on your belt and pull out a ring contained there. As you produce the silver band with inlaid sapphire, Sarah's eyes go wide. He quickly recovers, standing upright and looking you in the face.
You truly are amazing. I never thought you'd be able to recover my ring.
I told you I'm the best. You said it yourself. I'm the thief to hire when no one else can get the job done.
I'm impressed, young lady. Very impressed. May I hold it?
He reaches out his hand and you put the ring in his palm. He curls his fingers around it as he closes his eyes and takes a deep breath. You stand still in respectful silence. When he opens his eyes, the smile on his face is infectious.
You've more than earned your 200 pestados fee, he says as he takes a pouch of coins and tosses it to you.
Before you take your money and go, I have something else to give you if you have a moment. Oh, God. So here we go, chat. Will you stay and risk being late to your next appointment, or do you tell Sarah that you have a pressing meeting and leave? I have this sense that this is going to be one of those big, big turning points. So I just have a sense of it. So, there, either vote for stay and talk to your employer, who obviously already likes you, I'm just saying, or just go and leave him in the lurch and just abandon him there for no reason at all.
I'm resisting the urge to break into do I stay or do I go?
Do I stay or do I go? Yes, that is the case. Were there complexities, Neil, by the way, in this that were introduced separate from the skills? I know you said there were some things you were beginning to introduce that you had Dylan bring in at this point. Were there other complexities? Like, I know that with Appointment with Fear, that was a big step up in terms of what you guys were doing. So I'm wondering how much of an advancement this was in terms of stuff that you'd done before, technically, let's say.
Well, actually, because it took us quite a long time to do it. So we have lots of different engines now. A Point with Fear uses what we now call our Fear engine, and that same engine was used for To Be or Not to Be. And then we have our engine that that precedes that, which is basically this engine, and this is used for all the Gamebook Adventures titles and the Fighting Fantasy titles that aren't Appointment with Fear. So we had to make a decision when we were going to do Lords of New Wrath whether to appropriate it for our new engine or to keep it in the old engine. The problem is when we have to appropriate something for our new engine, it involves an amazing amount of work. And Dylan had written it in a way that worked with the old engine. I had edited it, and subsequent other people like Kamina had edited it in a way that worked with the old engine. So it was a business decision, I guess, it was cheaper for us to just run it through the old engine, essentially.
So moving forward, you are going to try, when possible, to start new games in the new engine, I assume?
We have, because we have a bit of a backlog of titles, so the next two Gamebook Adventures titles will still be in this old engine too. Just because, again, they were written a good 2 years ago, and it's better for us to do them in that engine.
I got you.
Having said that, though, future titles, we are currently working on The Warlock of Firetop Mountain, which is the very first title book.
Good stuff.
And that is using not the Appointment with Fear engine. That's using an advance on that engine again.
Oh.
And let's just say it's... how to put it? Let's just say I've had a 3D artist working with us for a year on that.
Ooh, so you're stepping up in class. That's the kind of thing I like to see. Is there any other, because you told me you had some updates, is there any other secret information that you're not supposed to reveal, which you could accidentally spill here? Not that this will be like publicly broadcast and then archived.
So obviously the Warlock of Firetop Mountain is our pretty major release that'll be coming up either later this year or early next year. But we're also working on two other titles at the moment, active. We were working on about 10 other titles, but the other two that we're, you know, properly heads down on. One of them is a licensed property, which we haven't even announced yet. Because the license holder doesn't want us to announce it.
Until now.
I really
hoped I could lead you into it without even... And that is Song of Ice and Fire. What? Oh my god!
It's very exciting. It's huge.
Nice.
It's one of the biggest RPG licenses you could get, really. In terms of kind of tabletop gaming and role-playing games. Mm. So... it's a pretty big deal for us.
Okay.
And that will be announced, I don't know, maybe a couple of months, I guess. And then we're also working on an internal project, which is our own IP, which is basically a choosable path adventure game, which is running to a different business model. So up till now, we charge, you know, $5 or $6 to buy our game. And we're actually going on a free-to-play model, which is interesting. It's a bit of an experiment for us, and we have a bit of a unique business model. We've already put it in front of some of the platform holders that will be selling the game through, and they seem quite excited by it. So watch this space.
So have we got a lot of pay-to-win, microtransactions? Well, is there horse armor, Neil? Is there horse armor to be found?
There definitely won't be, I can say this much, that there won't be any in-app purchases as such. But there will be another way we monetize it, which I'm not going to go into too much.
It involves a direct bank transfer without you knowing it. Yeah, I had a feeling, Shadow, it would not be D&D. I had a feeling it would not. And randomly D&D. It would be interesting. I would love to see that.
Yeah, and I saw the free to play there, and I'm not a fan of free to play either. But this business model would mean that you would actually never pay more than you would for one of our apps in any way. But it would just mean possibly opening up the market to have lots more people playing it, thus making the whole experience bigger and vaster and deeper. So.
Which reminds me, is there ever going to be a point, and I don't entirely know how to do this, what we're doing right here is probably the closest to sort of a multiplayer version of this, but could you conceive of some, I don't know, cooperative perhaps, or something like that, version of this? Again, and I don't even know, this is just off the top of my head, I'd have to think about how this would even be conceived of, but I don't know if there's like a voting system that could be built in or something like that, because it is enjoyable, I have found, to have, despite what chat occasionally does to troll me with it, it is funny to watch, and fun to watch them go through it. So has there ever been any talk about doing any kind of a is there ever a multiplayer sort of mode that you've considered, or is that just no way can that happen?
No, we've discussed this many times. We've talked about lots of different ways we could make interactive game books and interactive fiction, more make it enjoyable in different ways, and that multiplayer aspect is really a good way of doing it. The problem with multiplayer is, from a company the size of ours perspective, it does open up lots of cans of worms. You're dealing with servers and lots of other complex mechanisms, which is probably a little bit beyond us. Mm-hmm. I have seen other people do, like there was a few years ago a guy running a thing called Tweet RPG, which was just that, basically a little bit of an adventure, and everybody who followed him would be able to choose the next step. And that seemed to be working well for a while, but I can imagine that it was a lot of work for him, and I think he was doing it as a bit of a hobby rather than anything else. I don't know whether that's still going or not. But yeah, we've discussed it, and let's just say it could be something we could do in the future in some way, but
not at that present point yet.
Well, we kind of are, but the problem for us is it's very time consuming to write stories, especially branching stories, because there are so many possibilities, and so if we have to monetize that, sadly. I know it always comes down to money, but in order for us to keep paying our mortgages and our rents and keep our kids in school and all that kind of stuff, we need to do that.
Yeah. I understand. Well, it would be interesting to see if it ever kind of happened along those lines. It would be kind of neat to see if it could be done, but obviously that would be a concern. All right, let me close this poll. And again, for those of you who have come a little bit later, as the numbers continue to go up, which is great, we are lucky enough to have, and we're going to be staying to talk to this person, which is good. But we have with us the CEO of Tim Men Games, Neil Rennison, who you just heard, and also a friend of mine and writer, Dylan Birtolo, who wrote this game book and has written many other things. And actually, while we're on this subject, I should ask you, Dylan, what you've got out at the present. This should give you a chance to actually put in chat links to your stuff. Like, what do you have out at the moment? What do you have coming out?
That's a wonderful idea. it's like you've done this before or something. So the big one for me, there we go. The big one for me that just recently came out is the third book in my modern urban fantasy trilogy. The full trilogy will be coming out in e-format and print format and available for Gen Con this year.
So awesome. I'm
very excited about that. And I have information about that on my website that I just linked. I've also got a lot of short stories out in different universes. I've been in the latest Valdemar anthology, the Shadowrun anthology that was supposed to come out for Origins, that I'm guessing they're hoping to have for Gen Con.
I'm pretty sure they'll have it for Gen Con, to be my guess.
Yeah. It would be crazy of them not to.
Yeah. If John and people in this chat know John Helfers, if John has anything to do with it, they will. John, of course, Dylan and I both know John, but John plays D&D with me on this stream, so people are familiar with John here. So, yeah, John should make that happen. Make it happen, John. Do it. Do what's necessary.
Is he in the stream today?
I don't think he's not here right now. No, he's John used the incredibly imaginative Jay Helfers for his Twitch name, so we would know if he was here, and I do not see him as we speak. But anyway, okay, so you've got the Shadowrun thing coming out, and is there any other the biggest thing, I think, as you said, is the third book in your series, but do you have information you can spill that you're not supposed to, that you shouldn't have revealed, but accidentally, oh gosh, there it is, now I can't take it back,
I can share, so I've got some stuff that I can't share, but I can share that I've just been pegged to do some video game writing for a Fallout New Vegas mod.
Hey, there you go. Good stuff. A lot of people in this chat like Fallout New Vegas. Congratulations, man. That's awesome.
I'm super excited about that.
Yeah, that's cool. That should get serious love from chat. A lot of people love Fallout New Vegas.
It's a pretty intensive, complete overhaul mod, so.
That's cool. And that was just part of, like, community, you happen to be in the community, like, how were you tapped for it? Like, how were you?
I was tapped because I'm part of a game writing distribution list that had a call sent out for game writers to work on the mod. They had a couple of open writer spots, and I applied, sent in some writing samples, and they liked it a lot, and they said, hey, if you've got the time, we'd love to take you on board. And I think it took me all of maybe 3 seconds to decide yes.
That's awesome, dude. That's great. Cool. All right, let's see. Sarah leaves the room, bids you follow him. And by the way, just for a programming note for these guys, we're past the hour mark, so I will be able to let you guys go again whenever you guys need to go. I am not pushing you out. We're happy to have you here. But your guys' official requirements to stay are coming to an end shortly. So just letting you know, it's not going to go on for hours.
I'm so glad you stayed. I want to see what happens in this next section.
this is cool. All right, so Sarah leaves the room and bids you follow him. He leads you to a large library with bookshelves lining three walls, stretching all the way to the ceiling. You are momentarily taken aback at the sheer wealth of knowledge. You've never seen this many books in one place before. Sarah notices your hesitation and recognizes the wonder on your face.
I have a bit of passion for the written word, especially old Asurian. Asuria's children will rise again, mark my words, young lady, he exclaims.
I also see young lady, and then it looks like space one, and then a quote, I think. You might be able to see it on my...
Yeah, I think that's supposed to be an exclamation point.
That's an exclamation mark.
But is there a lady space exclamation mark?
Have a look. Yeah, it might be the way the I think the filter's working on that.
Okay,
might
be, could just be the font.
It might be going a bit wonky. Yeah, sometimes the filters, because the way we filter off things, because obviously it's choosing to say young lady or young sir.
I see, so that's kind of okay. Okay. Let's see. You're puzzled at his outburst, but brush it off as an old man's ramblings. He leads you over to a bookshelf near the corner and grabs one of the shelves at shoulder height, pulling on it. To your surprise, the entire shelf pulls out and slides up, revealing a hidden display case. Aha!
These are my personal treasures from when I used to practice your trade. I can't use them anymore, and I'd like to see them go to good use. You may take any one of these items. Consider this my way of thanking you for returning something dear to me.
Please tell me it's the flute. The flute! Oh, it's not the flute.
Oh, no.
God damn it. All right. We have the Boots of Silence, the Poison Dagger, the Never Caged Ring, or the Floating Pendant. All right, let's see. So we've got,
Remember how I said, depending on what you did, there'd be a choice that would drastically affect the story?
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
I can imagine. J. Jonah James mode. All right, here we go, guys. Are we going to have the Boots of Silence, the Poison Dagger, the Never Caged Ring, or the Floating Pendant? Man, all of those are awesome. I think, I don't know, if it were me and I were a thief, I think I'd be all about either the silence boots or the ring. Although floating is nice, because that implies not falling, and that's a positive thing. You have a lot of people on for the pendant, you have some people with the dagger, Obmi coming out in favor of the boots, Batty in favor of the pendant, Diddy's in favor of the boots, Shatter wants the ring. The ring. The ring.
And from a writing perspective, to me, this was one of the most interesting things because I wanted to come up with these essentially four, if you play Dungeons & Dragons or Pathfinder, almost artifact level items that can have a significant effect on the story, but still be able to tell the same branching story.
Mm-hmm.
I see. Yep. That's interesting. Yeah.
one of the skills actually of writing these kind of books is to make use of, add variation in there of things that can happen, but ultimately the narrative needs to be driven on in a way that, you know, feels logical.
Right. That doesn't seem incoherent in how it's all kind of constructed. Exactly, Shatter, my precious. Right. Rogan has voted for option 3 in the ring. All right, let's see what we've got. Igni to the face. Yes, of course we can, Igni to the face. Wow, so we've got boots with 3 votes, pennant with 3 votes, dagger and ring with 2 votes. You guys have no coherency at all. All right, so we've got boots or the pendant right now is in the lead. All right, we need to break this tie. We can't go with this. We can't have both. There should have been an option. Fight the man, take all items, and leave. Exactly, shatter those stats, yeah. What's up, Thor? How you doing, man? So yes, boots, dagger, ring, or pendant. If you have not voted, now is the time, people. Right now, boots, if they were floating boots of silence, I'd vote for that one. Well, yes, I'm sure you would. I shall fix this. If there were, right, if there were floating freedom dagger boots, obviously those would be your choice. You're really in favor of the pendant. Shadow's like, pendant! Pendant! We need floating.
It looks like the pendant's going to win.
Yeah, I think that's possible. Let's see.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. The pendant is starting to pull into the lead. All right, last call, people. Last call to get in your choice if you want this pendant. Let's take a look at the pendant you want. Are you going to get this pendant right here? It looks like it's got some kind of a triangle type of effect. I think I vaguely can make out the word curse and maybe Nosferatu, but I'm sure that's fine. I'm sure that's got nothing to do with anything.
Yeah, ignore the blood stains on the back.
Yeah, I'm sure that's no problem at all. The fact that the ring is still through a finger should not prove anything, I don't think either. Like, the floating pendant actually means only the pendant floats. Yeah, exactly. Only the ring is floating. I would have chosen the ring, but that would have created a worse tie. All right, here we go. And the winner is the pendant. All right, here we go, the floating pendant. Would you like to take the floating pendant? Whoever wears this can fall from any height and gently touch down on the ground. Yes, please. Terrible choice, he says no. You take your pick of the magic possessions and thank Sarad profusely. He gives you an almost fatherly smile and then waves you away, reading the impatience. You tuck the pouch of pastados into your belt as you sprint out the door and into the street beyond. The sun is almost touching the horizon now, and you are due to meet your contact at a tavern, the Duke's Scowl, just before sunset. Luckily, the streets have started to empty, making it easier to run. You move as fast as your legs can carry you, dodging around people and carts alike. I love how all the times you're supposed to make a check, it's done in all caps. It's like it's reminding you, make a fitness check! Like, this is the moment. Heart move! This is the way you should be doing it. Once again, no problems. First try. Wait, what? You have to be less than fitness?
Yeah.
Neil, what the hell is this? It's supposed to be equal to or less. Since when is that? I object strongly in the strongest possible terms. All right. Hoofer, nearly get trampled to death by a horse. Well, we got an achievement, so there's that. You rush through the street, air burning in your lungs as you try to get to the Duke's Scowl before the appointed meeting time. As you turn a corner, you see a horse inches from you. You try to skid to a stop, but your feet slip and you crash into the animal's shoulder. It panics and rears up, kicking out with its front feet. You barely manage to scramble backwards without getting trampled. A merchant rushes forward and calms the animal down by petting its neck and muttering soothing words into its ear. Eventually, it calms down and snorts in your direction. Your heart is pounding in your chest, partially from the run, but also from your brush with the near tragedy of not having an equal to or less, but only less. Viral. The merchant reaches out a hand and helps you to your feet while muttering a half-hearted apology. If you attempt picking his pocket, I shudder towards what this is going to do, but, pick his pocket, because reasons.
Because obviously he's a filthy, wealthy merchant who almost ran you over.
Exactly. All right, so pick his pocket, or are you going to pick his pocket because of reasons, or are you mad? So what are your choices, Jat? Yes, PJ Salt. It's me and the salt.
I chose poorly.
That's true, Batty. A thief should be able to poison, move silently, and never be caught. But floating, that's hard. All right, here we go. Yes, of course.
Oh, wow, this one.
The wave of pickpocketing. Yeah. Up, Sanity is making Sanity is making a return. Up, well, Batty is leaving Sanity behind again. Dylan, did you have a chance to play through this yourself several times, a number of times, like, or what? Or did you? I mean, I guess I shouldn't even assume that you played through it. Did you?
I'll apologize, Neil, in advance. I did not actually know this was released until the day after it was out. And I only found out because someone else wrote a review and my name came up in the Google alert. And I was like, look, I have this as well.
This is partly my fault too, because we were... this was released around a similar time that I was moving across to Australia. And everything got a little bit crazy in my life. And I'm usually the go-see guy to contact all the writers and illustrators to let them know when things are happening and blah, blah, blah. And it kind of got a bit swept under the carpet, sadly. So, my fault.
Interesting. Let's see. So, currently, Sanity is losing. Last call, guys, about picking his pocket. Would you say that this is more, and this is for either one of you, more or less combat heavy than the previous titles you've had? I guess, Neil, you would be the better historian on this task.
It's probably less combat heavy. One of the things I really love about this is the way Dylan really embraced these four abilities, because they actually play more of a role in it than the combat. And I think that's good, because one of the things I like to have with all our books is to have a bit of variation between, you know, to how the books kind of work. So yeah.
I believe, and I'm not 100% sure, but I believe that you can get all the way from beginning to most of the endings without ever having a single combat.
Oh, wow, nice. I like that. All right, well, Chad has abandoned Sanity entirely, so we're going to pick his pocket because, of course, we are. Let's do it. First, the merchant allows his horse to almost trample you, and now he decides not to show you the respect you deserve. He must be a traveler. No local would dare treat you in such a way. You see the pouch hanging heavily from his belt as he walks away. Perhaps it is time to help yourself and teach him a lesson about your reputation. Make a thieving... Actually, I feel like I should do my echo for this. Make a thieving roll! All right, we need to have a thieving roll. That's really important. All right, roll 1d6.
That so justifies my decision to have them in caps now.
Yeah, right. I mean, like, thieving roll! All right, 1d6. No! God bless him. We fumbled. You slide a small blade into the palm of your hand and reach towards the merchant's belt pouch. In one smooth motion, you cut through the cords, letting the pouch fall towards the ground. You attempt to grab the pouch midair, but miss and it clatters against the ground. The merchant glances down at the ground and then looks at you as you see the realization creep across his face. Thinking quickly, you point at the horse. I can't believe that he did that! The merchant nodded. That doesn't happen. Guards! Thief! The horse says nay. You turn to run away. You know there are more than a few guards who'd love the opportunity to put you in a cell. As you turn, you notice that the merchant was not making a general statement. He was calling to a couple of guards at the corner. They reach for you, and one of them grabs your wrist as you flee. He yanks hard, pulling you off balance, and you fall to the ground. Before you fully realize what is going on, the other guard gets involved, and both start beating you into oblivion. Eventually, a blissful darkness closes in around you. GG, chat. GG. Well done. When you wake, you feel cold stones underneath your face. You don't need to open your eyes to know where you are. Unfortunately, it's a location you've been familiar with several times before. You were in a stone-walled cell, barely large enough to lie down, and that's only possible if you stretch from corner to corner. Your entire body aches, and you can feel the bruises on your body as you shift to sit up and prop yourself against the wall. Based on past experience, you'll have a few days of this discomfort before they extort a fine and release you. Sadly, you have missed your opportunity to meet with your client at the Duke's Gal. The end. Fail.
Congratulations. I think that is the shortest possible route to an end.
I just don't even... I am just... Oh, and I don't think we ever saved it, did we? I guess I should have saved it. We're not going to go through the whole thing. I will... So we got the best ending. Yes, Maggie. That is clearly the best ending. No question about it. That is absolutely the best ending. Oh, my God. All right. Well, anyway, I'm going to roll my... See, our fitness is much better now. Now we're in a great place. So that's what happened with our thieving. But we'll keep this the way it was. We'll listen to the will of chat on this stuff so I can get back to where it was.
So for while you're getting there, from an interesting, from a writer perspective, when I was working on this and talking with Neil about everything, he said to me, very importantly, he wanted to make sure that there were no endings that could be reached just because someone made a bad choice. Like if you're in a dungeon and you decide to go left versus go right, he's like, make sure we don't have any endings where, oh, just because you happen to choose the wrong way, you die. And so I was like, okay. So I made sure, for example, with this ending, I was like, so what if it's a roll and it's very obvious that there's negative ramifications? And he was like, oh yeah, that's fine.
That's funny.
You know, in this situation, you've got to get to this appointment. It's very important.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's clear. So I managed to get us back there. Now that we've saved it, we had to at least save once. You'll be happy to know that our fitness is now 11, so this time we didn't run into that goddamn horse and the merchant. So this whole situation never happened. We got back there quickly. Oh, my God. Well, now we only have 5 left. But by the time your vitality this time is still very high. Actually,
it was in the 40s. It was 42, I think.
Let's see. I'm trying to remember which one of these. There we go. 42 out of 42, 11 out of 11 fitness, and then 6, 5, 4, and 4 in the abilities. And things you know, nothing of interest. Boy, ain't that the truth. By the time you reach the Duke Scowl, you are panting and stop for a moment just beside the door to catch your breath. You take several gulps of air and have returned to normal within a few seconds. Taking one final deep breath, you brush your hair out of your face and walk through the door to the tavern. You had 44, so that was pretty close. Pretty close, I would say. Guys, again, I am interviewing here Dylan Birtolo and Neil Rennison. Dylan is the writer of this game book we're playing, Lords of Nuroth, and Neil is the CEO of Tin Man Games and the grand poobah in charge of making all these decisions. Is the chief high overlord, etc. So if you have questions for either one, please do so. Ask those questions by doing question in all caps and then giving me whatever your question is in sort of normal regular lettering, and I will pass it along to them. We're going to let these guys go in another 5-10 minutes or so, because I don't want to keep them forever. So that's the case. Animaniac asks, question, Neil, do you think in the future there may be animations for the storyline? It sounds to me like he already hinted that that may be coming sooner rather than later, but I don't know. Is that true?
So at the moment, if you can imagine, when you're reading the game book, you're kind of following these paths. Let's just say that Wall of the Firetop Mountain will be involving miniatures. So we will have basically, because essentially what a game book is, the history of game books, the reason Fighting Fantasy game books exist is because Ian Livingstone and Steve Jackson were trying to write a book that described how to play role-playing games. And so the best way they could write a book on how to play role-playing games was by writing a kind of solo adventure game. And it was then that the book publishers picked up the book said, hey, why don't we actually make this the book? The Magic Quest was their original book, and that then became The Warlock of Firetop Mountain, and then the Fighting Fantasy series happened, and the whole explosion. So our thinking was, look, the game book really is just a solo game of D&D. It's where the book, the narrative of the story is basically the Dungeon Master telling you the story, and then you get given choices. I mean, in a game of D&D, you can do what you want. You've got infinite choice, but obviously a game book you haven't. So our thinking was, well, why don't we bring game books back to their roots, which is a tabletop game, actually visualize the game in a way that people that read game books and play role-playing games might like. So the whole idea was actually to have use actual metal miniatures but visualized in 3D, and have a map like you would have on your table when you're playing D&D with your friends.
Nice.
And moving the miniature around the map in the same way that the DM would do, you know, as you're going through the game that way.
It's a little Hero Quest-ish then.
Kinda.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the game book side of it is still very strong, but it's just a way of just, you know, it's like an interactive map, as it were. So that'll have lots of animations, and then from there, we thought, what would happen if we removed dice? And so, the Wall of the Fight Up Mountain won't have any dice in it, and the combats will be very different. So they'll go more to their tabletop roots in something, you know, such as chess, for example, is a good example. So
are you ready for the howls of protest from the traditionalists who'll be like, how dare you destroy our traditional values, you forward thinking, you progressive?
I am, and I've already got an answer to that, in that we'll also release the Warlock of Firetop Mountain in our old engine. So,
wow, so you're doing two in parallel development. This is a serious project.
Yeah, so people that complain about the new one will say, look, there's the... And the other thing just to add about the Wall of Fighter Mountain is we're actually rewriting it. And we're actually adding more to it. It's probably going to be tripled in length. There's new creatures in there. There's new backstories to why the creatures are in there, and lots of other things, so...
Wow, that's really... How many people do you now employ, Neil, full-time at Tin Man?
So there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5... There are 6 full-times and 2 part-times. And then we have a bunch of contractors around the world that we hire on and off for various things.
Okay, got you. Wow, are you going to be releasing Warlock on all platforms, including Steam? Or is it going to be Android, iOS, and then Steam, or... It sounds, Shadowed. Yeah, of course we're going to play this. I would like to have them back when that comes out, for sure.
So we're going Steam first with this, which is another new thing for us, because we've always been mobile traditionally and then porting over to desktop. So I've given the team basically a free rein to say, look, let's make this as good as we can get it on desktop, and then we'll worry about the mobile versions a little bit later.
Nice.
So yeah, very exciting.
I would agree, Adam. This is the kind of thing. I don't know about chat, but I'm pretty pumped up about it. It's pretty awesome.
You should see some of we've utilized. So we've had we got hold of a 3D scanner, and we've done a licensing deal with a miniatures company in the UK, and they sent us over boxes and boxes of metal miniatures.
Oh wow!
And we've been slowly scanning them into the computer. And then we've got 3D versions of those in the computer, and we're actually painting them in the computer to look like they're hand painted.
Wow.
So it's
that's and, slick. When is the vague ETA? You said sometime this year, right? Was the hope?
Yeah, I'm hoping later on this year. But realistically, we'll probably look early next year, I'm guessing.
Okay. The hell with realism. Listen, you keep those people 20 hours a day. They don't need to eat and sleep for a while. They're all fit and young people. They can handle it. Like, keep them up and just, you know, tell them, listen, work
through
the night.
They might be listening to this.
That's fine. Listen, I love all of you people. If it's Ben and Kamina, you guys have proven for ARFCON that you can get up early and stay up late. And that's what you have to do to sacrifice your own lives for the good of the gaming public that demands that demands these games early. That's really awesome, though. In all seriousness, that's really great. I would love to be able to get you guys back for, you know, a big epic release thing of that when it comes out. So hopefully we can chat about that more down the line.
Yeah, that'd be great. You'll be one of the first people that we fire it over to. So
nice. Oh, that's great. I'm that's really exciting. It sounds awesome. All right, let's get a few more pages here and see if we can actually not make screw up this time. As you pass through the doors, and don't forget, other questions can come for you guys. If anyone has questions about that cool stuff, that knowledge that was just dropped on us, please let us know. As you pass through the doors, several people turn to examine the new arrival. You get a few nods of recognition, and then they go back to their cups. As you walk to your regular table in the back, the two men sitting at it stand up and wander away. Sometimes it's good to have a reputation. Sometimes it's also good to be in a parallel universe where you didn't just get schooled by a horse and a merchant who can open. Before you sit down, a serving woman brings a mug of ale and rests it on the edge of the table. You give her a smile and slide 2 coins across the worn table to her. Easing into your chair, you sip your drink and wait for your contact to arrive. I'm a free QA during the stream. Is that what it is? Yeah.
I just thought that. And he's absolutely correct.
Let's see. Your table gives you... Yeah, that's true. Anytime anyone asks you this question, you'd be like, please refer to this video, during which... your table gives you a view of the door, and you watch carefully each time it opens. Most of the faces you recognize, and the few you don't, leave before finishing their first drink. The Duke Scowl is a tavern that likes its regulars and treats them well. Wait a minute. Do I see a terrible apostrophe sneaking in to the it apostrophe S? Do I see that? Is that apostrophe S?
I can't tell if that's an apostrophe or just a mark on
I think that's an apostrophe because it looks just like the Duke apostrophe S scowl, right? In that same sentence?
Let's have a look. Whereabouts are we?
Thank you.
It's like the fifth line down from the top of your table gives you a view of the door. And it's right in the tavern when you've arrived at the Duke Scowl.
Yeah, I'm just looking now. I can't see in here. What's the sentence in particular?
It says, the Duke Scowl is a tavern that likes its regulars and treats them well.
Yes, look at that. Yes, fixed.
but is not accommodating to outsiders who do not have business there, especially pro-Duchy folk from Orlando City. The sky has just started to glow. Is it, by the way, is it Orland or Orlandes?
Orlandes.
Or it is Orlandes.
Orlandes, yeah. Okay. That's how we pronounce it.
Orlandes City, okay. The sky has just started to glow red far to the west when the door opens to reveal a woman wearing well-crafted riding leathers and carrying a sword on her hip. She has a gold necklace with three rubies in it that catch the light of the fire and seem to glow on their own. Her long, light hair has a golden comb resting in it just over her right ear. Her appearance silences the general hum of the taverns that when she walks, you can hear her leather creak. She sees you sitting at the table in the back and walks directly towards you, removing her gloves as she moves. In the background, you hear, American woman! When she has crossed half of the room, one of the men in her path stands up, barring her way. He is large, no doubt one of the sons of the Ngaric family clan due to the blue markings covering his right arm. You can barely see her around his bulk. She stops and turns slightly to face him. He rubs the stubble on his cheek as his eyes wander up and down her body. Oi! What have we got here? He asks. The rest of the people in the tavern watch in silence, curious to see what will happen next. Will you... here we go. Apostrophe of doom. Will you talk to the Ngaric? Perhaps you would like to sneak up on him or watch and see what happens. Okay, let's see. Talk to... Eric? Sneak up on him.
I'd just like to add as well that some of these typos might have crept in post-Dylan as well, so...
Thank you for saving me, Neil.
No, it's true, because obviously we have to rewrite little bits and reorganize some of the sections, and sometimes, you know, these things happen.
Yeah, understood. Ah, see, this, now that's good for you, chat. You guys are doing exactly what I was thinking, which is you want to see what happens. You're like, what is going to happen with this person? Although Rogan wants to sneak up on him.
I'm getting that little like smile on your face you get as the DM when you have the entire storyline planned out and you see your players starting to do things and you're just like, yeah, I know what's going to happen here.
Yes, do what must be done. All right, so go ahead and make those votes. Also, I want to ask, I haven't had a chance yet to ask about the music and the sound design, Neil. I know you've got the same kind of atmospheric music here, or similar atmospheric music to what there was in House of Hell, for example. Obviously, Appointment with Fear was a lot more sort of upbeat, comic booky. But in future titles, like Warlock, for example, are you also advancing things on the musical side, or are you going to keep with more of the... kind of the general atmospheric background? Not that there's anything wrong with that, but I'm just curious.
The sound production will have to increase. You know, this is the as soon as you start adding in, you know, more complexity into your game, inevitably everything else needs pulling up as well slightly. So and the music's, you know, it's been great for our game books. It's perfectly, you know, it's really great compositions and whatnot, but you know, for something when you've got something that's a bit more visually attractive, I think people expect a little bit more from the interaction of the music. So yes.
Yeah. Okay. That's what I thought that might be the case. But All right. Let's see. So it looks like we're going to close that poll, and people are in fact going to wait for what happens. I think that's the right call. You lean back in your chair and play with your mug, moving in small circles. What's that, Dylan?
I was going to say, didn't you guys want to put all those points in persuasion? Jeez.
No, they were all about the they're all about that perception. So
oh, perception. That's what it was. Doing,
yeah. The little bit of ale still left at the bottom spins in a miniature whirlpool. As you watch, you can hear the Ungaric oaf's comments grow increasingly lewd and violent. No one makes a move to intervene. They all seem as captivated as you. The man reaches out and tries to put his hand on your client's shoulder. There's an audible slap as she smacks it away and she attempts to walk past. With a snarl, the man moves to intercept and tries to grab her again. She reaches out and puts her hand on his wrist. Rather than deflecting the grapple, she pulls towards her, yanking the larger man off balance. She drops her shoulder and thrusts her hip against his leg, flipping him over and across her back. He lands on the floor with a crash that shakes your table, just like that. In the space of an eye blink, her sword is drawn and the tip is pressed against the man's cheek. I said to leave me alone. Are we clear? She pushes the tip forward and blood trickles from the man's face. Good. With a flourish, she tucks the sword back into the scabbard and turns back to face you. She walks up to your table and sits down across from you without waiting for you to offer. I am Tava, and I have a business proposition for you. Yes, no, exactly, 1298. Tin Man Games is with us, but Ungaric is clearly not Tin Man. That would not be not be right, I don't think. As I'm sure you're aware, you have an excellent reputation. That is a buzzing to tell us not the case. I have heard that you are the one to contact when something rare and difficult absolutely must be procured. You smile and give a slight nod of recognition at the compliment. Tava grins and reaches up to idly play with her gold necklace. I represent a very wealthy man who wishes to recover something very important. He knows it is here in Nurath and requires your services to... She pauses as she searches for the right word. Liberate it. What is it that I am to liberate? A document. A solitary piece of paper. I'm sure that should be simple enough for one of your esteemed talents. You know better than to ask about the document. Such questions are not welcome in your profession and can result in the loss of an otherwise lucrative job. Instead, you ask the most important question. And the meaning of life? No, and my fee? My employer is willing to pay double your regular fee for the safe return of this document. I am prepared to give you 100 pestados now and another 300 when you complete your mission. Where is this document? An emissary fresh from Falavia has it in his possession. He is staying in one of the guest estates. Can you give me a detailed description of this document so I know which one I should take? Of course. Are the terms of the deal acceptable? Okay, so, last couple of polls here, folks. Do you agree to the terms or not? So let's see if you agree to the terms. Or do you negotiate? Dylan, were there times when you were writing parts of this that there were things that you thought were going to work, and then as you wrote it, you're like, eh, actually, I don't want to give them those choices or those options, or was that stuff that needed to come in your sort of interactions with Neil?
I would say both. There were definitely routes that I started going down, like especially with the artifacts that I had mentioned earlier. Mm-hmm. Like I originally had some other artifacts planned as well, and I just realized that I couldn't put them in either because they were game breaking for one of the story paths, or because they just made things far too convoluted. And then there were other things where I had to, like for example, what I was talking about earlier, where I had to go to Neil and I had to be like, okay, is coming to the end through this route acceptable? And there were times where he was like, no, I don't like that because it's too random. It doesn't make the character feel like they've earned their death. Or, I mean, those probably weren't the words he used, but those are the words that I'm using instead.
Earn your death. I like that. That's why I say to all my employees.
Earn your death. Okay, let's see. So, let's, yeah, sure, Shadow. Okay, so we want to negotiate, because of course we do. And so, hey, Beljor, what's up? All right, so we're going to negotiate. It is clear that this document is very important to your boss, so I think a special payment should apply. If Tava is indebted to you, and she's not, so have not earned her goodwill, I believe that twice your regular fee is more than acceptable to indicate the importance of this document. I would hate to have to add extortion to your considerable reputation. I meant no offense.
I just want to pause you for one quick moment because this is one of the things that I found fascinating as a writer is working with Neil. He said that there were these options to put these places in where it wasn't a choice and it wasn't a role, but we could show you that there was a way for you to have actually had a different result.
Right, that's interesting.
That was huge for me to be able to use.
Yeah, that's which is, of course, in the old game books had to do that, right? You know, if you've discovered X, Y, and Z, you know, or a lot of them had to. You know, if you discovered X, Y, and Z, then do this. Later on, there was sophistication with adding together numbers to get a particular entry, and that's the only way that you could have gotten to that entry is if you knew what was there. But before that, it was basically if you defeated the bandit on the way to the blah, 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 then turn, you know, then, you know, turn here. So you could see that there was a choice that you could have done differently. So, yeah, that's kind of a throwback, it feels like.
That's been a very important discussion point when designing these titles, because we actually can use filters now which filter out, you know, if you've already got the key, why does it need to ask you, do you have the key? It could just say you put the key in the lock because you've already got the key, and narratively that feels smoother. But the problem with that is then it removes a lot of the choices. Mm-hmm. You need that transparency to give people that feeling that they can replay it again at a later point. I didn't have the key. What would have happened if I had the key?
I like the idea. I like that idea that it gives you the sense of the doors you had to close. Especially, it'll be good for the completionists in the crowd that, you know, want to go back and do everything multiple times so they can get every, you know, ending and beginning and stuff like that. Yes, Bojor, the music is coming from the game.
Or when people get to the end and it says, "Do you have the flute?"
And you're like, "No, please return to level ? Yeah, that's me. Oh, God, that flute. These terms are acceptable. Good, I'm glad to hear it. Tava takes a pouch of coins from her belt and lays them on the table. She slides it halfway towards you and then removes her hand. I expect you will have this completed by morning. So soon? I'm sure one of your caliber will have no problem with a short timeline. I expect to see you at the abandoned farmstead just outside the north gate 3 hours after sunrise. I'm sure that can be arranged. Tava stands up and holds out her hand. You clasp it and are impressed by the strength of her grip. It is a pleasure doing business with you. I look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Would you like to try to pick her pocket as she leaves?
Oh, I love it. I love it. It's like it's almost like this was written for your audience.
Yes. So a new poll's been opened. One, pickpocket, or two, lol, what?
I love the way that you phrase the options.
Oh, God.
Oh, what? Look at that.
I'd recommend saving any time you see that question. I know, but I've only got six.
How many bookmarks do you have? Exactly. God.
It's true. You need to have an option like Arv's chat bookmark level, which is like 750, you know, possible.
I thought that was casual.
Say again. That's what it was
called. Yeah, it's casual mode. Yeah, we'll just rename it, you know.
Arv's chat's mode. Please don't name it my mode, because it's not my fault these people do this. I am going to save it here. I'm not taking any chances.
Well, you could at least wait till the poll is done. Because if the poll decides not to pick a pocket...
Right now it's tied. 5 votes for pickpocket, 5 votes for lol what. So... Exactly, Jen. Hope we don't pick more than 6 pockets. Exactly. Exactly. We got a tie here, peoples. Exactly, Specky. What?
You get to be the tiebreaker.
The thing is, I just showed you her kicking the ass of this brute who's like 5 times your size. And you're just like, I think it's, we have a previous, still fresh in the mind, is the fact that we lost to a freaking merchant, our incapability of picking the pot. God damn it. I'm telling you, it's going to happen. Z-Cat and Smacky, Adamaniac, yep. Insanity reigns. It's chaos. It's the chaos engine is brought to you by chat. Twitch plays Pokemon on steroids. That's what this is.
Oh my God, this is awesome.
I totally have to drop the best viewers on Twitch option. Most chaotic, most likely to lose their minds viewers on Twitch. That's certainly true.
Nice, Patty.
She should have negotiated. Yeah, that's true, Shadow. We were talking about this last time about superheroes beating up on thugs. The next thug is like, I got it. I got this. After you just watched Batman take down 5 guys. I got it, though. I saw what the first 5 guys did. I'm different. Yeah, that's true, Shatter. You raise a good point. You raise a good point. Clearly, Chad is no better than thugs. All right. Let's take our medicine. Poll close. Pickpockets, 7 votes. Oh, boy. As Tava takes a step away from the table, you reach to the pocket closest to you, hoping she doesn't notice. Make a thieving roll!
Oh, this should be good.
Now, the thieving roll is what now? It's adding... It's... What is it? It's...
You roll a d6, and you add your thieving skill. The difficulty varies based... So, for example, she's harder to pick than the merchant.
Uh-huh. Okay, here's the problem, people. I want to show you guys what our current score is. You see how we have a 4 in thieving? You know what 4 plus 6 equals? 10. 4 plus 6 equals 10. 10. The total must equal 11 or above. Please note, the 10... is 1 less than 11. Please note. Yes, 11 or more. Please note. Oh, look, a 5. Oh, we were so close. It was so close. We fail. You are immediately slaughtered. You feel some paper in the pocket and pinch it between two of your fingers.
I would just like to point out this is a greater than or equal, so you should be happy, right?
Yes. Nothing is impossible. God almighty. As you attempt to remove it, the corners catch on the edge of pouch. Oh, on the edge of pouch! At least we got another typo in the midst of it. Catch on the edge of pouch.
You should be up, got it.
And give a slight tug on her belt. You immediately let go, but it is too late. Tava turns and glares at you. I am more insulted at your poor technique than your disrespect, she hisses. Turn to 474. Oh, she doesn't immediately kill us?
Nope.
Tava turns to leave, and you watch as she exits the tavern. You wait a few minutes and then leave some coins on the table to pay your tab as you prepare for the soon-to-arrive inevitable death that came from doing this. When you walk into the street, it's still a little too early to conduct your business. There are too many people on the streets. Would you like to scout the building or get some rest? I'm going to recommend that we never go home and rest again, because clearly we're going to have 5,000 assassins now waiting for us.
So while you're running this poll, the whole engine that Tin Man has set up is actually pretty dang clever. And without going into too many details about it, right now the game actually keeps track of the fact that you have Tava's disfavor. And that does not come up again until like the last third of the book.
Great.
Yeah. I was just looking at the game book editor file. And I just suddenly saw that you pick up a little object there called Tava's Anger.
Yeah.
Now, let me ask you, I don't want to obviously spoil it, but when you do something like that, obviously it has an effect in the game. Does it make it, though, impossible for you? Like, is it sort of like the Kitchen is Doomed situation with House of Hell, where once you get into this loop, like, you're screwed? Can you overcome Tava's disfavor, theoretically? Or is it just like, okay.
Well, and without spoiling anything, there are a couple of very specific details in the end that are not going to be available to you because she doesn't like you. Mm-hmm. And it will make certain things that you might choose to do harder. But you are not written, like there's about 5 or 6 main endings, and I use that term loosely in terms of like they tie up the story in a way where it's not like, oh, you died, or oh.
So it's like one of the main endings we got when we ended up in jail, right? And we missed the appointment. That's clearly one of the main strong endings. Oh yeah, like one of the big top endings.
No, but seriously though, there are like 5 or 6 main endings, and you can still get to any of those at this point. Because I didn't, having played my actual classic story for this is having played Phantasmagoria and getting to the end of Phantasmagoria and not having 2 of whatever item it was you needed to survive the trap that like cuts off your head. And I was just like, well, that sucks. I don't have a save file that goes back far enough for me to get the other item. So.
Yeah, that's, I'm glad. Okay, that's good. I'm glad. Like, does this mean we can't hook up with her now? Well, sure, yeah. He says, and one, I think it was Mining Miner was like, choose 3, try to pick her pocket again. That was not a valid option. Maybe this will work. I admire your spunk. Gain Tava's enormous favor for some reason.
Just to say on the multiple endings thing as well, one of the beautiful things about this particular game book that I really enjoyed was a lot of our other game books sometimes do just have the one ending that you're having to try and find. And the endings in this story are, it's not unfair. It just changes the world slightly. And the interesting thing for me as the world designer is which ending do I take as canon?
Right, yeah.
Because that's... obviously things change significantly. So, yeah.
How much is this built into the... How much does this impact the universe going forward, the events of this book one way or the other? Is it more of a side story nestled into, you know, the universe of much larger stories? Or is this relatively significant, you know, in the overall progress of the universe, etc.?
Well, it's not the world's not going to end, there is, like I was talking earlier on about Game Book of Vengeance 4, Revenant Rising, and this whole thing with Falavia. This book, depending on how you end it, does have ramifications to the political structure of the country. And you know, that's while, you know, not as exciting as, you know, maybe a dragon coming to burn everything, it's still pretty important in terms of, you know, if we've got future stories that we want to tell, do we take off from that point? Because, you know, people are going to live their lives a lot differently depending on some of the actions that you take right now. So,
yeah. So it does. So this has definitely got some good movements. I like that. And I've often, I'm getting a little bit more into this now because I have the Icarus series is going to be, has got a whole universe kind of built into it because we're doing a game in parallel development. And then my series starting next year, the deal that I signed with the Ed Greenwood group for my Grey Assassin trilogy, working with Ed Greenwood, who is the master of, you know, universe continuity and like understands all of the way that the things all kind of move together. That was fascinating to me, watching a real continuity expert be able to explain how my world and my stuff was going to be able to fix into it, was be able to fit into it, and how what happened in my tale and in my city ultimately will have ripple effects on the rest of the world. And the fact that he's able to keep that straight in his head, I mean, he's had 3 decades of practice at it, so I guess there's no one who should be better at it than Ed. But it's just really, really impressive to see, to be able to keep the entire sweep of all of these writers, all of us writing within that world, with our own narratives, you know, and being able to keep that sort of, you know, square in his own mind. So I'm always amazed with the continuity experts of the world people, you know, not just the tale people.
I mean, for me, because I don't know whether you know this, but Orlandez was my D&D world, which, you know, was 25 years ago. I first drew the Orlandez map, you know, when I was about 15.
Nice.
And the wonderful thing for me is I have so many talented people like Dylan just populating my world and pushing it forward. And there are people and there are events that have happened in previous books, which were what happened in my D&D campaigns with my friends around the table after school. Mm-hmm. And it's so wonderful just to have all these people just moving all that forward. It's a real pleasure.
Yeah, that is really cool. You know, getting a chance to see, and on a much smaller scale, seeing a couple of short stories written in my Icarus universe, that's a trip. That's a trip to see people kind of take it and run with the ball.
Neil, when you do move forward with this, I'd be really curious to know which of the endings you run with to advance your world, because as you pointed out, they are drastically different from a political standpoint.
Yeah. I mean, the two books that follow this, the book that's immediately after this is set in a completely different part of the world and has no impact. The last book, which we're actually still editing at the moment, there are situations that we might have to change depending on which what we take as canon as the final the final ending. So I'll let you know.
What gets chosen? Let's see, you've already had, so Chad has chosen to rest. You've already had one adventure today. You want to make sure you're fresh for tonight. It's likely to be a long night, especially if you're meeting Tav in the morning. It'll be far better to be sharp and refreshed when you begin your work, in before you sleep through the meeting and fail. You make your way back to your hideout, a two-story house close to the center of town. You climb up the wall to one of the second-story windows, the only window not barred from the inside. You check a piece of straw stuck near the hinge. It is still in place and unbroken, letting you know this window has remained shut since you left. That's a nice touch, Dylan. I like little touches like that that show that the author has really invested themselves in the mind of their character. And, of course, this is what a character would think. It wouldn't just be, let me have this one window be unbarred, but let me actually have a viable way to see whether anyone's come into it, because thieves are paranoid by their nature. So I like that.
Reason.
Yeah, it's good stuff. You remove your warning system, push the window open, and enter. Once inside, you make sure all the windows and the door to the stairway are still barred from the inside. Then you ease onto your bed and close your eyes, drifting off to sleep. You wake up and glance out of one of your windows. You recover up to 3 lost vitality, and you feel refreshed. The moon is high in the sky, full and bright. This is both a blessing and a curse. You'll be able to see better, but so will your adversaries. You dress in plain clothes. That way, if you are caught, you might be able to pass yourself off as a servant. It's currently late in the evening, and the streets are likely to be mostly deserted. Farmers and laborers will have retired for the evening, having to start their day before sunrise. Exactly, Bojero, but you forgot to check the front door, which is wide open. However, the merchants, lords, and emissaries are likely to still be up doing business or enjoying themselves. You could attempt the theft now, when you are more likely to be seen by a random passersby, but will have more time for your attempt. Or you could wait a few hours when almost everyone is asleep except for the watch. This also means that the emissary will most likely be sleeping in the room with the document. So, okay, this will be one of the last couple choices, and then I do want to let these guys go. They've been with us for 2 hours now, which is much loved and beyond the original agreement, but I'm very grateful for that. So, let's see. So, poll open, leave now, or wait until after midnight. Okay, so you guys can either leave now or wait until after midnight. What's the choice going to be? Do it now or wait till after midnight? When you will turn into a werewolf and be highly effective for that reason. Because of things. Would you say, by the way, and this is for either one of you, what was sort of your greatest influence specifically writing this book? I mean, Dylan, obviously you've been gaming for a long time, so was it fighting fantasy stuff? Was it D&D stuff? Was there a particular influence in writing this book? And then Neil, I guess same question for you. Was there a particular influence, I guess your own D&D campaigns? I guess you've kind of answered that already. But I'm wondering about, for this particular book, was there a specific influence that was on either of your minds?
For me, I forget, and I'm absolutely horrible about this, but I forget what book series I was reading. But the book series that I was reading at the time was a fantasy series, and it was all about political intrigue. Mm-hmm. And it didn't have a lot of fighting, and it didn't have a lot of, like, there were armies, but, like, the armies going to battle were never described, because it was more about the political side of things. And so
I love that kind of fantasy, by the way.
Found that fascinating, and that kind of fed into this story, because I wanted to, like, we're just starting to get into it, and I don't think we're going to have time on the Twitch channel, but this story is, you're going to see that you're pulled into something that has huge, like, both Neil and I have hinted at, political ramifications, and that was kind of, for me, what I really wanted to do, which is why using a thief seemed perfect for it.
I see. Interesting. What about you, Neil?
Yeah, I mean, I look at our series as a whole, and we hadn't really had a thieving story as such. And so when this, you know, landed in my inbox, it was just like, yes, this is the one. This is going to be great. And just from a nostalgic thing as well, like we talk about my old D&D game. I used to have an old school friend called Alex, who I haven't seen for many years, but he had a character called Ajartha Blackhand, who was a thief in Orlando's city, and he used to steal things and leave a little black imprint of a hand on the owner's house somewhere to show that he'd been there. It was like his mark. Mm-hmm. And when I was reading this, it really evoked that nostalgia of those old D&D sessions. And I think even with Alex's character, we used to run that character as a solo mission. Like, he'd come around just to have little adventures just with me, like to have little thieving jobs and stuff.
That's cool.
And so it was really nice in that way. So.
Yeah, that's cool. There's not nearly as much attention. It's one of the things I really like about having moved into the 5th edition out of 4th edition, is 4th edition was so combat heavy, which is, frankly, my least favorite part of D&D. I like combat fine, but of the combinations that are out there, I much prefer the storytelling, the political intrigue, the, you know, diplomacy, the persuasion, the interactions, you know, that sort of thing. And so I like that 5e has sort of moved in the direction where you can do more of what you're describing, which was more of an old school thing too. You know, like second edition had a lot more of that possibility, as opposed to just like heavy fight. So.
Yeah, so I'm definitely into more about the story. I mean, I was an old second edition player and DM, so yeah. All about story for me, about the world and the people that live there and what they do on a day-to-day basis, really.
So. Amen. That's what I like about that stuff, too. Okay, so the chat has decided. All right, to wait until after midnight, which we will do. While you're anxious to start on your mission, you know it is far wiser to wait until the streets are just about abandoned. You feel at home in the dead of night, and avoiding the few patrols or drunk citizens will be a trifling matter. The sleeping emissary will never know you're there. You bide your time by going over your equipment and practicing some sleight of hand. When you are done, you exit, which is important since you seem to be incapable of actually pickpocketing anyone successfully. You continually bash your hand into the table to indicate your lack of ability to pickpocket. When you are done, you exit through the window, replacing your length of straw, and climb on the roof of your building. You sit on the edge and watch the city slowly fall asleep. Lights go out one after the other as taverns close their doors and people crawl into bed. Soon, the only lights that remain are those in larger estates that can afford to burn wood or torches throughout the night. Still, you wait, watching the moon and stars dance across the clear sky. After a while, you climb down from your perch. It is time to get to work. The streets are completely abandoned as you make your way to the estate, but still keep to the darkest shadows as a precaution. It isn't long before you come to the grounds. If you previously visited the estate, you have not, so... You arrive at the estate and see that there are a few lingering lights through the ground floor. There are still people standing in front of the main entrance. Several guards are also there, watching and helping people onto horses or into carriages. There is far too much activity to enter this way. Staying on the opposite side of the road, you walk around the estate looking for another possible way to get in. You see the window that leads into the emissary's private chambers. You could climb up to the window, but would be exposed if anyone happens to look up at the wall. You notice a back entrance with a single guard standing by it. Servants come in and out of the door, but the guard pays close attention to each of them. Will you climb the wall or masquerade as a servant? Let's see. Climb the wall or masquerade as a servant, chat. What's it going to be?
So one of the things that I tried very hard to do when I wrote this was that I actually tried to make it so that you could choose to tailor your experience based upon the skills that you have. And so, for example, like, you know, obviously if you start doing, it should be pretty clear in some cases whether or not you're pursuing something that's a more stealthy route or whether you're going to be more open, because there's two different kinds of thieves, right? There's the kind of thief who's never seen, and then there's the kind of thief who is everywhere, but no one remembers them, or they charm their way in, or they talk their way through.
Right.
And so I tried to make sure that you had paths that could be specific to the stats that you had chosen in the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's logic. I was just thinking as you were saying that about Hans Gruber in Die Hard, you know, I'm an exceptional thief, Mrs. McClane. I mean, he's not about stealth, right? He's about sort of not making it clear that what he's doing is thieving, in fact.
Right.
Have you decided... What is this? Let's see what Chad just said. Have you thought about hiring Arv as your narrative voice?
As your narration voice? I just thought that.
That's funny.
You'd be great.
Aw, thanks. He seems good at climbing. He does it every day to get into his house. Climb the wall. 2 votes, masquerade as a servant. 5 votes are at last call. This is going to be one of the last 2 decisions that we'll make tonight, or at least with these guys on. Last call. I was waiting for someone to say, Matt, climb the wall while masquerading as a servant. Someone sees you're like, I'm sorry, I was trying to get in the back entrance, but I couldn't fit, so I didn't want to put anyone out. I thought I would climb up this.
So do you want a little bit of a spoiler while you're waiting for the last call in terms of what one of the artifacts would do and what you could do with it here?
Would it, well, I'm trying to think about, because I have a feeling I know about one of them. Let me close the poll. Okay, so now we're masquerading as a servant. Would the floating pendant have helped?
You have the floating pendant.
Right. So I'm saying, like, would that have helped us fly over the
water? I'm not going to spoil that. I'm talking about the artifacts you didn't
see. Oh, I see. I see. Yes. Okay. So yeah, go ahead and spoil it for me. Hi, Rocket Chris. So,
the Never Caged Ring actually allows you to open a hole in walls or the like, and you can actually go right through the wall.
Sweet. That's cool. All right. No,
we had a great illustration for that as well. One of the artists had to visualize what that looked like and did a great job.
So it's Portal. You basically portal it.
Right, pretty much.
Yeah.
That's it.
All right, yeah. So Masquerade...
There's no cake, though.
Yeah, no. Masquerade is a servant. All right, the cake's a lie anyway. You stride confidently up to the guard at the back entrance, not bothering to hide your approach. There is no way you will get past him unnoticed, so you might as well try to bluff your way past him. When he sees you coming forward, he puts a hand in his sword and holds up a hand to order you to stop. Who are you? And what are you doing here? You explain to the guard you were hired as additional help and need to be allowed access to the job you're hired to do. I'm seasonal, bro. Like, I'm only here for... He looks at you closely as you explain how unforgiving your employer will be if you're late. You must make a persuasion roll! Let's see.
I love that.
All right, total must equal 11 or above to succeed. Now, fortunately, we do have a higher number here.
Hey, damn it.
Get it. Man, these are rough. These skill rolls are rough.
Yeah, this is a particularly hard skill roll here.
The guard narrows his eyes as you weave your story. His suspicion is aroused, and he studies you closely as you explain your errand. His eyes catch the daggers tucked into your belt. He quickly draws his blade and puts the tip at the base of your throat. Your clothes are too nice for a servant, and your boots are too expensive as well. He smiles in a way that makes your skin crawl. Looks like you'll be enjoying the comfort of a cell tonight. Somehow you have a feeling that once you get out, Tava or her employer will be less than forgiving. The end. Oh man, well that seems appropriate as a good finish. Those are for these exactly what are. These are for cutting lettuce. These daggers that you see before you. Oh my gosh, that's funny. All right, well, this was a lot of fun, guys, and I'm very grateful that we were able to be joined by both of you to do this. I really hope that Lords of Noroth gets more attention because it seems like it's a lot of fun. I'm going to actually, once I let you guys go, we'll probably play a little bit more of this and see if we can actually get into the freaking house before, with that thing destroyed. So that'd be nice. I really appreciate it. As you know, very much have a lot of love for Tin Man Games, and this is a lot of fun. So can we get some serious love for Dylan and Neil in chat? Dylan, Neil, thank you guys both so much for being on. I really appreciate it, and hopefully we'll be able to get one or both of you on again in the future.
Yes. I really enjoyed this. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Dylan and I will see you in a couple of weeks at Gen Con, of course. Thank you so much again for putting me in touch with Neil in the first place. And Neil, again, continued success. And I will hope, I'd love to be in touch with you again about the Warlock thing. That sounds super awesome, and I would love to be able to feature that when it comes out. So
I might even send you some sneaky screenshots that you know, as a special.
I like sneaky screenshots. I would love that. I would be super excited about that. Thank you guys so much. I will be chatting with both of you at different times over the next couple of months. But thanks, guys, so much.
No problem. See you. Right.
Thank you.
Have a good night. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Cool. All right, guys. That was awesome. I was very, very pleased about that. Now, bear with me for just a second. I know you can't see me. You cannot see me. The reason for that is because... let's see. Hold on a second. Let me delete that. Reason you can't see me is because... There we go. Is because my webcam doesn't want to play nice with that. So, again, thank you so much, Neil. I appreciate it. Of course, my webcam is not. Does anybody know, is there a way to... let me log out of Skype first. Is there a way to reinitialize your webcam in OBS without having to shut the whole thing down and start up again? Does anybody know? Is that possible? I will not bear with you. Does anyone know, is there a way to do that or not? I have no idea if there is, but...